Emily Chang has had more than 20 years of experience as a strategic business leader. She is known for innovative brand building. She did this most recently at Starbucks, where she was the Senior Vice President of Marketing. Loyalty, customer engagement, and digital tender. Those are just a few of the ways that she has impacted the brand. Prior to Starbucks, Emily was the Chief Commercial Officer at IHG, where she was responsible for all commercial functions across Greater China. Emily developed her marketing expertise at Procter & Gamble with 11 years of end-to-end business experience across all three business units, spanning everything from upstream design to retail marketing with Walmart. Those are some pretty big names. She holds a bachelor's degree in biology and an MBA in competitive strategy and finance. In her free time, Emily enjoys writing and teaching. Emily believes that leading a purposeful life of yes can pave the way for a meaningful personal and professional life. Please join me in welcoming Emily Chang to the stage.
Good morning. I'm so glad to be here with you guys today. And a special hello to all of you who reached out before today to say hello and ask some questions on LinkedIn. Way to make the most of your time. As you probably saw on the NRF website, I was invited here to speak on saying yes and dancing to life's rhythms and what that opens up for you in terms of opportunities. You might be wondering then why my slide actually says raise your hand. Well, let me step back a little bit. I started my career at Procter & Gamble, as Sarah just said, and that's a place that everybody knows is the ultimate in terms of training brand managers, future general managers, and also teaches you about how to design, curate, and develop brands. How many of you are familiar with that phrase, brand equity? Okay, good. And if you aren't, I actually think you might be. So, for instance, let's do a little engagement here. You can just shout it out. What is the Apple brand known for? Awesome. And what is Nike known for? It's amazing. And what is their brand slogan? You guys are amazing. And here, let me ask you one more brand slogan. What's yours? Just like every brand is known for a discrete description that identifies who they are, what they stand for, and what's unique about them, I believe each of us should also have a brand statement that defines who we are. As you prepare to interview and talk to people about why they should hire you, the more clear you are about your brand statement, the more they will be clear on why they have to bring you onto their team. Just out of curiosity, by show of hands, how many of you feel like you would be able to, I won't call on you, how many of you feel like you would be able to share what your brand equity statement is today? Okay, good, there are a couple. But if you don't, take that down as a little bit of homework. Just think about what that might be. And it'll change over time. So for me, it has changed, but that's why I wrote raise your hand. I think for me now, it's a good representation of who I am as an employee and also as a leader. When you say yes, you raise your hand. When there's an opportunity to volunteer or get involved, I will always raise my hand. The other reason I like this statement as a way of reflecting who I am is because I think about my curiosity. I love to learn new things. And what do you do in class when you have a question? You raise your hand. Now let's go back to what you saw on the website, because I don't want to leave that hanging. Dance to life's rhythms. What is that all about? I saw this quote maybe 15 years ago and fell in love with it. Dance to life's rhythms instead of making life march to yours. And I have to tell you, as a Chinese American born to two immigrants, this is a very un-Asian idea. We don't dance to life's rhythms. I was given three choices growing up. You can be a doctor, a lawyer, or an engineer. By all means, choose. Luckily, I actually really loved science, and I chose medicine. I was fully bent from the seventh grade on, which is crazy to think about because my daughter's now just finishing the sixth grade. I was her age when I said to my parents, I want to be a pediatric oncologist. I was certain I wanted to help very sick or dying kids who were suffering from cancer because I had seen something that really impacted me, and I thought, I think I can do that better. So I was pre-med, I studied biology, I got into med school, and I got into an MD MBA program. So all was right in the Asian household. Until I had this major experience working in pediatric intensive care, and I realized that what drew me to this work is exactly why I couldn't do it. I don't have any emotional distance. I ended up deferring med school to adopt the first kid I saw who needed help. And she ended up in a foster family, so I thought, walking away from that experience, I need to find something else to do in my day job. And I, since I'd been enrolled in an MD-MBA program, I thought, you know what, maybe I'll get an MBA. That seems like a really good place to kind of explore and think about what to do next. I didn't know the first thing about business. I felt like, especially back then, people wore like pleated khakis and carried a briefcase and walked in and out of buildings, but I didn't know what happened in between. But I thought, since I'd studied science all my life, maybe math makes sense, and so I studied finance. And after my first year in MBA, I was invited to a number of internship interviews. One of those companies was Procter & Gamble. And one of the many people who've leaned into me was my interviewer, who I'm still in touch with today, Paris Watts Stanfield, said to me, you know, I would be glad to offer you this finance internship. I think you'll do fine. But as I talk to you, I wonder if you might be interested in brand management. And in this really deep intellectual voice, I answered, what's brand management? I had a huge opportunity, and I didn't even know it. I didn't know how kind of prestigious these internships were at Procter & Gamble, but I had a chance to go. And that's what internships are for. They're for a chance to say yes to something you may not know and learn and see if that's something that you like. I spent 11 years at P&G, and that company was amazing. They gave me so many opportunities to explore, because when you join a company like Procter & Gamble, you get these questions, you know, in your work and development plan. What do you want to do? What's your career aspiration? Well, obviously, I didn't know, and so the only thing I wrote was, I'm here to learn. I'd like to take every diverse opportunity that the company can offer me to see what brand management looks like across the chain. And that's exactly what I was afforded. I had a chance to go to Guangzhou, go back to China. Even though I spoke really crappy Chinese at the time, I had the chance to work in front-end innovation, which is working on product development for things that aren't in the market and won't be for years to come. And I had a chance to move to Arkansas and work with a company I deeply admire, Walmart. Where better to learn the nuts and bolts of retail? In fact, my daughter was born in Fayetteville, Arkansas, something that she's perhaps not as proud of as she should be, but we'll work on it. You know, we're in Shanghai, and all the kids, they only have this like tiny frame of reference, right? So kids would ask each other, where are you born? And you'd hear on the Shanghai playground, Rome, Paris, New York, and then you'd hear my daughter, Arkansas. So even at a young age, she learned really quickly. I heard a few weeks later, somebody asked her, where are you born? She was like, States. But I loved my time there. And you know what happened? When I said yes to these opportunities that maybe moved me not to the best of places by some, but for me, I thought they were awesome experiences. We've loved everywhere we lived. A couple years later, I got an email from what looked like Apple recruiting, even with like a little pink apple under the signature. And I remember my first reaction was, is this a hoax? I don't think I know anybody at Apple, and why would they reach out to me? Well, they liked my China experience, they liked the classical CPG, Consumer Products Group experience, and they liked that I had had some experience in retail. So I had the incredible privilege of taking on retail marketing for Asia Pacific, starting with China. And you know, once you go into retail, it's very hard to go back. Because when you grow up in the world of CPG, let's say this is my product, I'm responsible for this product, partnering with different functions to develop it, improve it, distribute it, supply it, sell it, and my goal is to have this thing on a certain shelf at a certain retailer, in a certain position, merchandised on the end cap, and ideally faced out 5 times, right? That's my job. But I have to partner with the retailers to try and influence where I want that product. I have to try and get the best data I can to understand how my product is doing and how my competition is doing. These are a lot of challenges that we face as we look at those partnerships. It's also a lot of great opportunity, and that's one of the pieces of work that I had the opportunity to do when I was working for Procter & Gamble and in partnership with Walmart back in those years. But when you join a retailer, you suddenly feel like a kid in a candy store. you get all the data you want. You know how many products you sold, when you sold them, who you sold them to, which salesperson sold them, and whether that customer is coming back again. You can see their life journey as they experience your brand over time. You have this incredible privilege of a customer not only trying to find your product on the shelf, but walking into your store and saying, tell me more. And you have 45 minutes on average with them as you engage. It was unbelievable. And this idea of customer experience started to change the way that I was thinking about traditional marketing. Then I got the invitation to join Intercontinental Hotels Group. And that's hospitality, and I know we're here talking about retail, but we're also talking about saying yes. I'd never thought about hospitality before. I mean, I really didn't even know how hotels were run, the different franchise versus managed models. But it seemed like an incredible opportunity because thinking about the customer experience and the guest experience, it's not that different. In fact, it's richer. I stayed at the Even Hotel down the street last night. When you think about what a guest entrusts with you as the hotel, it's their most intimate personal moments. Guests are sleeping in your beds, they're eating your food, they're getting married in your ballroom. You get to be a part of the greatest life moments of your guest. It also taught me a completely different level of holisticity because you don't have a shelf anymore where your product is sold. You sell in the online space, right? And so when you think about how do you sell and distribute hotel rooms, my world got blown up again. I got to think about direct or owned channels like your website, your app, your call center and walk-ins, and indirect channels, which is when you sell through intermediaries in the hotel world like Booking.com or Expedia. Obviously, these intermediaries will give you a much bigger reach, but you pay a commission for every sale. So how do you maximize your revenue across all your different channels? Not to mention loyalty programs, which I got the opportunity to look after for the first time, and how important it is to really engage our guests in a meaningful way. How do you leverage data and unlock the potential, not in a creepy way and fully respecting privacy, but in a way where you can start understanding what is the guest looking for? How do I maintain relevance, engage them at the right time, in the right place, with the right message that's delightful? It was addicting. And then I got this call from Jim at Starbucks recruiting, and we had been in contact for many years, and he said, you know, we've got the CMO job. I thought, at this point, I'm not sure I want to be a CMO. I'm not sure marketing's really my thing. I love this idea of running a business. I love customer experience, and that chief customer officer title really resonated with me. But I realized it's not about the title, because what I'd fallen in love with in terms of this digital enablement of guest experience, nobody does it better than Starbucks. I think about the ability to stay on the phone. That's a phrase we used to use, because think about how many apps you download, and after a week, you don't really use it, you delete it, right? So how many apps are sitting there somewhere on the third or fourth screen that you've never even looked at anymore? You only look at them when your memory's full, and then you have to start deleting stuff. Well, what does an app take to stay on your phone and get used regularly on your home screen? How many are there? I mean, other than my Tesla app, Starbucks is one of very few, and I thought, what a privilege and opportunity to learn how they do personalization and CRM. So, what just happened? Okay, somebody will have to tell me later, maybe in the first Q&A, please. Anyway, I got the opportunity to join Starbucks and learned a ton about how the app is developed and how we engage with our customers and create that same holistic online meets with offline experience. When you look back in those 20 years, they went really quickly. And I danced to life's rhythms. I could never claim to have architected any of my career, but what I would say is I said yes. When there were opportunities, whether it was about moving or trying a different industry, I said yes and felt like I had the opportunity to learn so much, not just about jobs and industries, but about corporate cultures and who I work for, how to manage people, how to work in different countries. And all of those experiences have led me to where I am. And as I'm just exiting this pace, let me stop and pause to talk about what I called professional halftime. It's my little hashtag I coined. My daughter was just 10 years old, and we had spent the last 8 years in Shanghai. She mentioned one day, could I just live in America, maybe for a year? I'd like to just see what that's like. Our family's really involved in social justice. And so she was really big on seeing what freedom of speech looks like. And you know, it's not all positive. So she's had the opportunity to see what that manifests as day to day. We had the chance to spend time as a family, doing a lot of things. So my husband and I both took time off, like hiking on Blake Island. We had the chance to reconnect with friends, because while living abroad is hugely enriching, and I highly recommend it, doesn't matter where, just get out there. But it also does wear on your relationships back home. So we invited 9 different families to stay with us those last 6 months. We took trips. We went to a lot of different places that you might traditionally hear some of the older folks say, I'll wait until retirement. Have you heard that? When I retire, I'll go to New Zealand. I went to New Zealand last week. When I retire, I'm gonna write a book. When I retire, I'm going to. But our life is different now, isn't it? And yours even more than mine. We're no longer working 30 or 40 years, hitting something in the mid-50s, and then retiring. I can't see myself retiring in 10 years. So, also, I don't think it's safe or healthy for a 70-year-old to kite surf, or bungee jump, or take a 24-hour survival course, and all these things that I wanted to do. So, why not pause? And take, but it takes a little bit of courage of conviction, right? Especially with Asian parents, to say, nope, I'm not gonna work. Well, when are you gonna start again? When I find the right thing. In the meantime, I have a couple things I wanna get done. It doesn't go over very well, but it was awesome for our family. It also gave me a chance to pause and think about, okay, if that was the first 20 years, what does the next 20 look like? What's important to me? Where have I really thrived? What am I looking for? Where can I best contribute? And I came across this thought of a social legacy. You know, we often hear the phrases, your purpose, your life purpose, or the legacy you leave behind one day, and those are really big thoughts. I also was really focused on social media. And thinking about these internet trolls who hide behind a screen and make snarky remarks, those guys are leaving a social legacy, right? I think about celebrities who use their platform for good. They're leaving a social legacy. Every time we tweet, we tap, we post, we comment, we're leaving our own social footprint, as well as offline. When we invest in the community, when we invest our resources and our time to contribute, those are ways that we're leaving something meaningful behind. And so I pause to think about what is my and my family's social legacy. And this tied in really nicely with the biggest passion project that I worked on these last 6 months, which was to write a book. I did not wait for retirement. And the book is called The Spare Room that I'm working on. I had a chance to, because I'd been kind of drafting and working on it for a couple of years and realizing it's just really hard to do that, I had dedicated time to write the book, and figuring out the publishing world, it's not an easy thing. I had the opportunity to sign with an awesome agent who I love. She took me through the process of writing a book proposal. I put up my own website. And actually, this is an awesome pivot point, not at all intentional, but where she's pitching to publishers this week as I head back to work. So you're finding me truly on the last day of my professional halftime. It was an awesome, awesome time. And the spare room is our social legacy, and I think it serves as a euphemism for what this idea is all about. Over the last 21 years, I and then my husband and I as a young couple, and now the three of us, have hosted 16 young people in our spare bedroom over the last 21 years. It was never through a formal fostering process. It was across 4 or 5 different cities around the world. We've always met, somewhat coincidentally, if you want to call it that, a kid who was hurt, abused, neglected, and needed a safe place to stay. And I started thinking about this, like, what are the chances 16 different people found us? Most of them were complete strangers. I think it comes to this intersection of two things. One is your offense. What is that thing in society that really offends you? You know, even in my mile walk here today, I probably saw 5 or 6 things that were sort of, didn't rub me the right way and thought, this could be better. But there's always one thing for each of us that I'd call the offense, the thing that really irks at us, that gets to our sense of justice. And alongside that, there's our offer, which is what we bring to resolve or partially help that offense. And when you find the intersection between your offense and your offer, I think that is where you find your opportunity to discover your social legacy. For me, it was The Spare Room, and I'm so excited about pitching it. As we move forward, I can't share with you where I'm going yet. Somebody just asked me backstage, and I'm like, I know it's kind of silly because I start Monday, but we have to let the organization know first. But I am moving into my second half. And you guys, while I'm moving into my second half, you're entering your first half. So I hope that today, by sharing some of my experiences and reflections, you might say yes a little bit more. You might think about your own brand equity. Who do you want to be? What's your aspiration, who you are today, and who you want to be in 10, 5, 10, 20, 50 years? What's the social legacy you'd like to leave behind, such that when you look back at your professional halftime or further down the road, you'll look back and smile and you'll say, you know what? I lived that life of meaning and intention. It was a life well lived. We can continue this conversation. My website, a lot of you guys have found me on LinkedIn already, and I believe this is the time that we're going to transition into a couple minutes of question and answer. So thank you so much for your attention, and I look forward to talking further with you.
Hi, I'm Lauren. I'm a sophomore at the University of Wisconsin-Madison, and I'm actually from Bellevue, Washington, and I worked at Starbucks for a few years in high school, and I was always really blown away by how well they treat their employees and all their customers. So I was just wondering if you had any insight as to how that developed within Starbucks, kind of from like the start to the to where it is right now. Like, how did you get the idea for that and all those programs they have for their employees and customers?
Yeah, and that's what drew me to Starbucks as well as the digital element. Yeah. I think Howard Schultz has often been quoted as saying, we are not a coffee company serving people, we're a people company serving coffee. We don't refer to our employees as associates, they're partners. And that was really what drew me. I think the operations team at Starbucks is incredible. Yeah. They're the ones that work with all of our partners, who are the ones who fundamentally bring the brand experience to life every day. I learned this at Apple as well, which is avoid the ivory tower. It's very easy when you're in a corporate job to sit really far away and think about great designs to go execute. But unless you're sort of in that front line and engaging all the time, you have to make it part of your job to do that, because that's where you start understanding the pain points that you can resolve so that your partners can really bring that great experience to life, but also where you have the greatest opportunity to delight customers. Yeah.
Thank you.
Is there a second? Hi.
Hi, my name is Caitlin Norris. I'm from Georgia Southern. In the beginning, you talked about how you didn't really know anything about business going in, and now you do marketing. I was wondering, what did you think it was going to be before you knew what to expect, and then what is it now that you're doing it?
I really didn't know what it was going in, but you know, I almost had, in some ways, the benefit of a clean slate. So I was trained in brand management, and I think that's a little bit different than marketing, as it's sometimes referred to. It's something I've thought a lot about, and certainly it's been published. There have been lots of articles published about the idea that CMOs are now being called all these other things, right? CGOs or CBOs or whatever else. I think fundamentally the idea of a commercial leader is somebody who's responsible for taking whatever product or service you have and bringing it to the right person at the right time in the right place in the right way. It sounds really easy, but it's not that simple to think about, right? Whereas I think sometimes we get caught up in that lingo, and that's where I've been reading a number of articles where they say, is the CMO dead? How come CMOs are fired every 16 to 18 months? I think marketing in its traditional push mindset isn't relevant anymore, right? In this age where we have incredible access to data and understanding who the customer is that we serve and the channels through which we can reach them, it's our responsibility to be commercially relevant, again, by cultivating the right proposition to the right person and delivering it in a way that's delightful.
Thank you. Hi, my name is Anna Nixon. I'm a senior at LaSalle University. I wanted to fill you in the giggles during the app thing.
Yes, please.
It was the subtle flex of you saying Tesla app was your favorite app. That was kind of like my thing, but.
Oh, okay. I love my Tesla.
Yeah, it's a good flex, it really is. My question is, one commonality within each position that you had within the industry, going from like a fashion, or not even fashion, more of a brick and mortar like Walmart to a Apple where they're selling technology, what was the one commonality that made you feel like this is for me, or I wanted to remain within this industry? And then my second part would be like, what made you know that it was time to move on to a new position?
Yeah, great questions. First, I should clarify, the reason I love my Tesla more than anything else is it farts when I put on my turn signal.
No, that's
it's
great.
It's like, that's undeniable.
Honestly, one of my main goals in life is to get a Tesla, so I agree.
What was the commonality that made me feel like this is the right place? For me, you know, everyone's formula is different for what makes this work context the right one for you. For me, I think it's always been really important who I work for. Is it somebody I respect, who I feel like somebody who has my back? Is it somebody I can learn from? And is it someone who's gonna give me some space to grow? So interviewing is as much about telling them why they should hire you as it is about convincing yourself this is the right place to be. I think from a culture standpoint as well, I wanted to see that I was in a learning and flex environment where I could constantly grow. But it's not just about what's in it for you, it's also about your contribution. And we have this in our office, in our home. It's a really simple formula. My contribution divided by my consumption has to be greater than one. I want to leave more than I consumed, and I want to leave every place I've been better than I found it. So when I look at an opportunity, I think, is this something that I can leave better than I found it? Is there an opportunity here for me to add value? And at the same time, can I continue to learn and grow? And when I have those two things true for me, with a boss that I really believe I can respect and learn from and support as well, wholeheartedly, that for me is just the formula. And I think everyone will have a different one.
Awesome, thank you.
Yeah, my pleasure.
Hi, I'm Hannah Oliver from Mississippi State University, and I was also born and raised in Arkansas.
Woohoo!
I was wondering, what's the best advice for incorporating your passions into your career?
That is a great question, and that's really what I've been thinking about a lot. I think it is about saying yes. I don't want to oversimplify, but you know, when I was at Procter & Gamble, even in the earlier days, I was invited to the affinity group, Asians and Marketing. I was actually Asians and Marketing and CMK because we didn't have enough scale, so we had to combine functions. But it was an awesome place to get started and start understanding what affinity groups look like, because I grew up ultimately in upstate New York, and I was never really part of a group like that. And when I went to Midwestern Ohio, it suddenly became a little bit more clear to me where the value is in networking with people of similar backgrounds, right? And then I had the opportunity to start supporting the Women's Network. And then our CMO, Mark Pritchard, who's still there today, invited me to help lead this sort of cross-affinity group, pan-affinity network, to leverage the best of each of those groups. And it just became more and more, and I learned more and more, and I felt like my contribution went deeper and deeper. And it all started with kind of saying yes. Now, not indiscriminately, because backstage there's another great question, which is, do you say yes to the point where, you know, you're overwhelmed? Because a lot of people here are hustlers and go-getters. No, I think it's going back to the core of what's my brand equity, who am I and who do I want to be, and how do I think about that social legacy that I want to leave behind? And does this help me get closer to both of those things? And if it is, then it's always served me really well in all the companies I've worked in.
Thank you.
Thanks for your question. Go Hogs. I see hands. Should I be taking more questions? I think I'm at time, actually. I'm so sorry. But find me on LinkedIn. Those of you who did will tell you that I will always answer you. And I look forward to speaking with you guys more. It's been such a pleasure today. Thanks for your questions and your interest.